we're one of those lucky people that can travel anywhere.
Yes, ma'am, I know.
And they sometimes call you nomads.
It's been many years since I started out for that goal.
Frances McDormand reached out to me after having acquired the book Nomadland by Jessica Bruder. Her nonfiction book really showed me just how extensive that community is and how interesting the lives of the people that were in the book. The goal from the beginning was, how do I create a journey that could seamlessly incorporate all these rich details and interesting characters that Jessica has met during the years of research she's done.
It is a tough time right now. You may want to consider early retirement.
I need work. I like work.
One of the things that was really exciting for all of us was to go to the actual places where the work is done.
50 plus days across 5 states. I love the opportunity of having this many days to shoot a movie in this many places. What most people call unconventional way of filmmaking, and then really give it time, and we can go anywhere.
I was getting close to 62, and I went online to look at my Social Security benefit. It said $550. I'd worked since I was 12 years old. So I'm online, and I find Bob Wells' cheap RV living. I could live in an RV, travel, and not have to work for the rest of my life.
Peter Spears was the first person who read Jessica's book. We both thought we wanted to try to see if it could be a film. Just before that, I had seen Chloe's film, The Rider, at the Toronto Film Festival, and thought it was extraordinary, and thought that Chloe might be interested in the people that it was telling a story of.
The book is about Americans on the road. They're people who've moved into vans, RVs, people who have left traditional housing behind. Many of them are at or near retirement age, but the America they're living in now isn't the same as the one they grew up in.
Economic times are changing, and so my goal is to get the lifeboats out and get as many people into the lifeboats as I can.
What we got from Jessica Bruder's great book was the immediacy of the story of these people. And though it takes place technically in 2008, it still felt so of the moment and felt very much like something we were all experiencing in some way. This idea of wanting community, this idea of our shared sort of humanity, this shared human experience we all have.
I think you've come to the right place to find an answer. I think connecting to nature and to a real true community and tribe will make all the difference for you. I hope so.
Nomadland is quite a touching story, and it causes you to pause and reflect on your own life.
It was very inspirational. It made me believe in humanity and the strength of yourself.
It's amazing how you can feel when you learn to spend more time being happier with what you have than unhappy with what you don't have.
These people are able to find connection.
Home isn't something that you own. It's something that you carry with you.
This is a learning lesson for all of us.
Get in a van, take a road trip somewhere.
It honors people that do it differently.
It's a really heartfelt love letter to what it is to be human.
My mom said that you're homeless. Is that true?
No, I'm not homeless. I'm just houseless. Not the same thing, right?
No.
Don't worry about me, I'm okay.
Her ability to connect in the present moment with another human being, whether they're a trained actor or non-professional, that's just friend. We need to make sure we don't put anything between that and the audience.
I'm sure you took good care of him, Vern.
Chloé is using the form of cinema to touch upon the lives of real people who are completely on the periphery of society, very overlooked.
What's your name?
Fern.
Fern?
Derek.
Hi, Derek.
As an artist, I like to see what's beyond the horizon. So for someone coming from a city in New York, Los Angeles, I would like to go beyond that horizon, see who else is out there that I can connect to.
I think I've lived a pretty good life. I've seen some really neat things, kayaking, all those places. And the swallows flying all around. And reflecting in the water, so it looks like I'm flying with the swallows, and they're under me and over me and all around me. It was just so awesome. I felt like I'd done enough. My life was complete. If I died right then, that moment, I'd be perfectly fine.
Over the course of Chloe's films, she's grappling with this American dream idea, and it's not lost on any of us that she's not American, and so seeing it with perspective.
Chloe found a way to tell an even bigger story.
Like Chloe, I'm in love with the American West and their film. The writer absolutely blew my mind. Once I'd watched it, I knew Nomadland was in fantastic hands, that it was going to feel like a poem on the road.
I love this lifestyle. It is a lifestyle of freedom and beauty and connection to the earth. Most of us in this lifestyle use a 5-gallon bucket. Most of us are in vans or something larger. I'm in a Prius, so I use a 2-gallon bucket. If you have bad knees, you could use a 7-gallon bucket.
Molly, your cast is made up of seasoned performers like Frances McDormand and David Strathairn, but also some non-professional actors who are so fantastic. How did you go about finding all of them?
It took a few months of gathering names and people that would be interested in being in the movie, and it was through Jessica's connections, and then Sue Ann Carlson, who does the 5-gallon bucket lesson. She was a really great connector to the people that would be interested, and kind of culled all of that together along with pictures of their rigs. Chloe could then speak to all the people on set or prior to the shoot and decide then who she wanted to highlight.
Hi, guys.
Jessica did a great job to introduce these characters, these amazing people to us in her book. And through Jessica, I was able to meet each of them and got to know them and heard a lot of their stories. And our challenge was, how do we incorporate their stories into Fern's journey? And we choreographed Fern's journey in a way so that can come organically.
It's like they're dinosaurs.
Nope, watch out. Watch the steps.
Whoa. Chloe and Fern have presented us in a very truthful manner, and I felt that every minute I was making this movie.
It's a great document of a very specific time in our world, and it takes a lot of courage to commit to the life, and I'm really humbled by it.
Chloe, when I watch these beautiful montages, which tell us so much about Fern's life and the way that she's existing day to day, I think to myself, I'm curious to know if you had all of that kind of planned out, almost like in a storyboard form, or was it more of a question of shooting as much as you could and then dealing with all of that in the editing room and putting it all together then?
It was 50-50. We knew from very early on that it's going to be not just a passing through space, but also time. We schedule the production according to the season. The palette of the location changes. You know, snow, desert, redwoods, badlands. In the edit, it's trying to figure out how to make us to feel like a year has passed with those little short montage. And then once we got there, it's really up to Josh to find the most iconic image that can represent that place.
Josh, when I watch the scenes in the van, I think to myself, how did you even do that? How many crew members could you fit in that van to get everything done that you needed to do?
Yeah, it was quite a squeeze. Yeah, I mean, thank goodness the cameras are growing smaller and smaller nowadays, and the technology is there to get cameras into, you know, different environments and places in ways that you hadn't seen before. Shooting inside Vanguard was most of the experience, really. It feels like most of my memories, like me and Fran doing a sort of do-si-do inside the van and cursing ourselves that we didn't build one on a stage or something. But, you know, hopefully there was an authenticity to shooting in those real places.
Hey,
Find anything interesting? Rocks!
One of the most interesting things about the life of the van dwellers is that it is nomadic, and they travel from season to season and from job to job.
To produce something like this is extremely difficult. So at the very beginning, I needed them to tell me what kind of parameters am I working in. Just talking like, what's possible?
We shot in so many different locations, so many different environments, just sort of ready to adjust to whatever comes along. Filming with, you know, real nomads, filming with real beet farmers in Nebraska, filming with real campers, and following this character of Fern as she like navigates this world.
The RTR is a boot camp for beginner nomads.
What's RTR stand for?
Rubber Tramp Rendezvous. It is in Quartzsite, Arizona, out in the middle of the desert on BLM land. You should come.
We're just trying to kind of discover, you know, life through this character's eyes. The camera is there as a sort of witness to that.
Joshua, that tracking shot seems like it's so organic and effortless, but my understanding is that it was actually quite complex. Can you tell me about everything that went into getting that right?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a great shot to focus on in terms of what everyone did, the whole crew who were a part of like creating something that feels organic, like it's happening spontaneously, yet we're capturing it with a more sort of cinematic gaze somehow. We did have some influences, like Hal Ashby's shot in Bound for Glory, I think was one of the first ever Steadicam shots that took you through all these traveling workers. It's just a great way of serving both character and environment, because we're following Fran from a distance and it's wide enough that the audience, the eye can kind of search the frame. But we're still, Chloe's still grounding us in this woman's emotional journey.
All right, let's just do one. Action. Oh, that's perfect, actually. No, right there is perfect. So we're gonna wait for the sun to get a little more dramatic.
Between 4 o'clock to 7 o'clock, it's the most stressful thing you can imagine.
We call it the magic hour hustle.
It's that feeling of like waiting for something important that's about to happen and anticipation.
This was one take, that's it. We just have an incredible producing team organizing everything, queuing everyone. You have to plan for everything that could happen.
The magic of the film is the degree to which you should have no idea what is staged and what is reality. RTR stands out as the single biggest production or art challenge that we took on in the film, because we completely staged it from scratch.
I wish that we had a video of our crew doing this, because it was the most beautiful coordination I have ever seen, because we have these big, huge vehicles. I think there was like 50 of them. It was like very, very organized.
Into that point, how many people were in our company and how few people were actually orchestrating that shot? I kind of like the idea of just letting the big crews know how fast and nimble a smaller crew can be.
Because shots like that can really fall flat if they don't feel totally lived in. But, you know, we had a small crew, but really dedicated to doing that. It feels as real as the spontaneous moments in the film.
If you combine the production infrastructure of staging this huge undertaking, to me, it's kind of emblematic of how many layers of reality we're playing with at every moment of the film.
Nomadland's cinematic language is very specific. The emotional connection. How can we bring that into the soundscape?
Throughout the entire movie,
who has such a great location recordist who's given us such beautiful real location sound, and then we really just emphasize that.
The great thing about Chloé is that she's extremely precise. Her style of filmmaking, in terms of her desire to have a smaller, tightly knit group of filmmakers on set, that ultimately influences the kinds of recordings that Wolf Snyder, the production sound mixer, was able to capture in these very intimate and small environments where you physically feel like you're in the space.
Our incredible sound design team just rebuilt the entire soundscape. So you're not only watching, but you're also hearing things.
Is it on?
It's on.
All right. Which hand do you want it on?
Because your ears are actually getting much sharper when you're out there without all the city noises. Really creating a emotional soundscape for Fern.
We have a lot of layers, sounds off screen, that can improve and embrace the scenes. It's immersive. The idea was to put all the elements and preserve this balance between all the atmospheres, all the music, everything that involves the sound to be an authentic piece of art.
You see that? My dishes that my dad gave me, he collected these, Linda May, from yard sales. And when I graduated from high school, he gave me the whole set.
Oh,
isn't that
beautiful.
Great? In collaborating with Chloé about the character of Fern, we talked a lot about how we were going to bring things from my life, from Fran's life, into Fern's life. That is my dad, Fern. Gone from this world, but watching closely, I'm sure.
I love this. Look how beautiful photographs used to look.
That was something I could bring to the story that gave it more personal depth. It's like my dad used to say, what's remembered lives. I maybe spent too much of my life just remembering. I couldn't pack up and move on.
Welcome and thank you for coming to the Rose Bowl on a very smoky night.
A film is a different creature than a book. They're different art forms, but the way they dovetail, I love how Chloé and then Francis were able together to cut a path through all these worlds that have meant so much to me. To see them link them like beads on a string in this really beautiful way has been incredible to watch.
That's the way it was meant to be seen. It's amazing!
I see incredible stories scattered everywhere. All these places across the country, they're working. These folks, you don't hear about them for a reason. It's a shame.
Where are your mom and dad?
Back home in Wisconsin.
Think they worry about you? You don't get lonely? Got a girlfriend anywhere?
Well, to be truthful, there's one.
Mm-hmm.
I write letters to her.
Oh, smart man. Very good. Letters are good.
If people can understand that you can live without all the common things you're so used to, I think it'll bring people better understanding of what the human being really can take and how resilient they can be.
So are you quitting on me?
No, I'm not quitting.
My life is built on not having, not craving, not needing. Most people don't understand.
I have more resources and more happiness and joy in my life now, and I can never really show my gratitude for that.
Oh, I just see something neat.
There's something about the vastness and the beauty of the American West, that is something that has inspired generations. We definitely set out to capture that.
Are you sure you don't need any of this stuff?
No, don't need any of it. I'm good.
People are stepping into the world of a Chloe Zhao movie, and Chloe's constantly just waiting and having patience and shooting enough to capture those real moments and then exploring life from a certain perspective that doesn't feel purely observational, that there's a poetry to it.
What the nomads are doing is not that different than what the pioneers did. I think Fern's part of an American tradition.
With the films that I've made, they're people who live in the peripheral of society. And sometimes they're captured in very harsh journalistic lenses. You know, it's a camera with very unforgiving. And I think it's really important for us to put a cinematic lens in their lives so people understand why they chose that lifestyle.
Salute to the airship.
Airship.
To the airship.
From Francis and Chloe to every single person we hired, we all were so wanting to tell this story in this way.
There's something very relatable about this tradition of rugged American individualism. So while these people often are finding themselves by economic necessity sort of pushed to this moment, they're also discovering a independence in a way that they never have before. That is very inspiring.
Whoa, that's nice.
You look really good in that chair.
When we feel like we're hurt and when we feel like we're lost and we can't really find a way out, it reminds you that you're not alone. It reminds you you're part of something bigger. There's a way to persevere that makes you feel hope at the end.
One of the things I love most about this life is that there's no final goodbye. And I don't ever say a final goodbye. It's just say, I'll see you down the road. And I do. I see them again. And I can be certain in my heart, I'll see you again.